Which day is the Bible Sabbath? Why do so many Christians worship on Sunday? Was the Sabbath changed? Stay tuned. Hi, this is Dustin with Hope Through Prophecy. On this channel, we help you understand Bible prophecy and be prepared for the soon return of Jesus. Make sure you are subscribed with all bell notifications on so you don't miss any future uploads. This video is part of a series called Final Days. To watch this full series in order, just click on the link in the description below. To receive the notes for this meeting and all others in this series, make sure to register for free by clicking on the link above. Have you ever noticed that things aren't always what they appear to be? For centuries, scientists believed that the Earth was the stationary center of the universe, and everything, including the sun and stars, orbited around it. It was a free-thinking Polish man, Copernicus, who determined that the Earth was itself in motion and revolved around the sun. Consider the story of the spider. Aristotle classified the spider as an insect. Insects, it was known, have six legs. So for centuries, no one questioned the great Aristotle, and it was just commonly assumed that spiders were insects and therefore had six legs. It was Jean-Baptiste Lamarck who presented the classification of the spider as an arachnid having eight legs. Merely because something is believed for centuries doesn't make it true. Could it be that a tradition like one of these long-held ideas has slipped into the Christian church? Is it possible that many have accepted a falsehood in the place of truth and very few people today question it? Is it possible that today, just as in Christ's time, that His church could be setting aside a commandment of God to follow a tradition of man instead? A tradition so old that almost no one knows how it started? A tradition nearly all Christians accept, thinking they are following God's law, when in fact they are following something of completely human origin? That is why we have chosen the theme for our meetings. If it's in the Bible, we want it. If it's not in the Bible, it's not for us. The book of Revelation predicts that Satan would attempt to mislead the Christian church, so the great dragon was cast out, that serpent of old called the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world. He was cast to the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. Satan is a deceiver. His goal is to overthrow God's throne. But what is the foundation of any government? Where does its authority lie? In its ability to make laws. If your subjects refuse to follow your laws, they really are refusing to be your subjects. So Satan has attacked God's law, but right in the heart of God's law is the Sabbath. So isn't it logical that Satan, the great deceiver, would attack the Creator by challenging the symbol of creation, the Sabbath? There are honest-hearted Christians who read the Ten Commandments written with God's own finger and see the Fourth Commandment, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. They're confused. The church that they're attending keeps Sunday, the first day, not the seventh-day Sabbath. Many honest Christians read in Luke 4:16 that Jesus, as his custom was, went to church on the seventh-day Sabbath. They read that Christ said in Matthew 24:20, that his disciples would be keeping the Sabbath 40 years after the cross. They read in Acts 13:42 through 44 that the Apostle Paul taught a whole city to keep the seventh-day Sabbath. They read in Revelation 1:10 that the Lord has a day. And they read in Luke 6:5 that the Sabbath is the Lord's day. They read the same thing in Mark 2:27 and 28 and Matthew 12:8. They are confused and asked who changed the Bible Sabbath. Certainly God didn't, because the Bible says, "For I am the Lord, I do not change." Then they look at the Bible and they see Jesus didn't change the Sabbath, because the Bible says Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. God did not change the Sabbath. Jesus would not change the Sabbath. And the disciples could not change the Sabbath. But Peter and the other apostles answered and said, "We ought to obey God rather than men." So the question then is, if God didn't change the Sabbath, if Jesus wouldn't change the Sabbath, if the disciples couldn't change the Sabbath, Who did it? In the book of Revelation, chapter 13, we read about a beast that rises up out of the sea. This chapter is where we read about the mark of the beast in 666. But notice how the beast is described. Then I stood on the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rising up out of the sea, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and on his horns 10 crowns, and on his heads a blasphemous name. A beast in the Bible can be a political or a religious power or kingdom. This power that rises up is a blasphemous power. It claims rights and powers that only God has. It continues, "Now the beast which I saw was like a leopard. His feet were like the feet of a bear." Remember these animals. We will see them again shortly. They are what? A leopard and a bear. And his mouth like the mouth of a lion. The dragon gave him his power, his throne, and great authority. Who is this dragon? Satan. Satan imbues this power with great authority, so the whole world listens to it declare its own laws in place of God's law, and the Sabbath becomes a particular object of attack. To understand this beast, we go back to the book of Daniel, the 7th chapter. Here we have the same imagery as Revelation 13, the lion, the bear, the leopard, and the dragon. Daniel 7 gives us the key to unlock Revelation 13 and understand the whole subject of the mark of the beast in 666. We read in Daniel 7, starting in verse 2, Daniel spoke, saying, "I saw in my vision by night, and behold, the 4 winds of heaven were stirring up the great sea. And the 4 great beasts came up from the sea, each different from the other. 4 beasts arise from the sea. They are different from each other." Notice this key to interpret Bible prophecy. Those great beasts, which are 4 kings which arise out of the earth. Thus he said, "The 4th beast shall be a 4th kingdom on earth." So Daniel sees 4 beasts that represent 4 kingdoms. These 4 world-ruling kingdoms, which start in Daniel's day, take us down the stream of time. There are also 4 kingdoms represented in Daniel chapter 2. Those metals in the image symbolize Babylon, Medo-Persia, Greece, Rome, and divided Europe. The vision of the beast adds more information to the vision in Daniel 2. It brings to light a power that would arise during the time of divided Europe, an attempt to change God's law. Let's look at how the Bible predicts what would happen and see clearly how history confirmed what actually happened. Now the first beast. The first was like a lion and had eagle's wings. I watched till its wings were plucked off, and it was lifted up from the earth and made to stand on 2 feet like a man, and a man's heart was given to it. The first beast was like a lion with eagle's wings. When the archaeologists were digging in Iraq near the site of ancient Babylon, they found engravings on the walls of a lion with eagle's wings. In the ancient world, people knew that Babylon was represented as a lion. Then another nation was to rise. Babylon wouldn't rule the world forever. And suddenly another beast, a second, like a bear. It was raised up on one side and had 3 ribs in its mouth between its teeth. And they said thus to it, "Arise, devour much flesh." Now notice that the second empire is like a bear that raises itself to one side. The combined kingdoms of Media and Persia overthrew Babylon. The bear of Medo-Persia, raising itself up on one side, represented the Persians overthrowing first Babylon, then dominating the Medes. What does the bear have in its mouth? 3 ribs. When Medo-Persia conquered the world, it first conquered Babylon. Then it went northward and conquered Lydia, then southward and conquered Egypt. These 3 nations, Babylon, Lydia, and Egypt, represent the 3 ribs. Do you see how accurate Bible prophecy is? It's absolutely amazing. The third empire rises. After this I looked, and there was another, like a leopard, which had on its back 4 wings of a bird. The beast also had 4 heads, and dominion was given to it. What was that third nation? Babylon, Medo-Persia, then what? Greece. Exactly right. What do you know about Greece? Who was the most prominent Greek leader? Alexander the Great. He was just over 30 years of age when he conquered the entire then known world. Greece conquered the world quickly, as represented by the leopard with wings. Why the 4 heads? Notice once again how perfectly these beasts of Daniel line up with the four major world empires of history. Alexander the Great died when he was 33 years old. Unlike most kingdoms, Alexander's son didn't take the throne. Instead, his four generals divided the Greek Empire and each took a portion to rule over. The Bible describes a fourth empire. After this I saw in the night visions, and behold a fourth beast, dreadful and terrible, exceedingly strong. It had huge iron teeth. It was devouring, breaking in pieces, and trampling the residue with its feet. It was different from all the beasts that were before it, and it had 10 horns. It is very clear that this fourth beast with iron teeth represents the Iron Kingdom of Rome. This period takes us to the time of Christ. Rome ruled the world in the days of Jesus. Christianity grew up in this Roman Empire. The Bible describes the collapse of the Roman Empire clearly in the symbolism of toes of the image and the horns of the fourth beast. The image of Daniel 2 had feet and toes of iron and clay representing Europe. The fourth beast here has 10 horns. Rome was divided into 10 main divisions. During the time, the barbarian tribes were overrunning Europe. Religious apostasy would enter the church, and there would be a conflict over worship, and the Sabbath would be changed. I was considering the horns, and there was another horn, a little one, coming up among them. In Europe, among these 10 horns, there is another power that arises, before whom 3 of the first horns were plucked out by the roots. And there, in this horn, were eyes like the eyes of a man, and a mouth speaking pompous words. The Bible says this little horn arose and was different from all the rest. The Bible gives us evidence to clearly identify this power. First, the little horn comes up among the first 10 horns. If the 10 horns are divisions of Rome, this little horn has to come up in Western Europe. This little horn doesn't come up in Asia, Africa, North or South America. Its roots are in European soil. Secondly, the Bible says this little horn would arise after the 10 horns. It doesn't come up in the days of Babylon, Medo-Persia, Greece, or Rome. It comes up after the fall of the Roman Empire. It is a power that rises out of Rome in the early centuries. The Bible also says that this little horn has eyes like the eyes of a man. Eyes represent intelligence, but it is man's wisdom, not God's. It is a human religious system based on man's teachings which would arise out of Rome. Notice the Bible says in Daniel 7:24, it is diverse or different than all the rest. He shall be different from the first ones. This one is different. It is not primarily a political power, it is a religious power, a religio-political power. What would this power do? It would attempt to change the very law of God. Notice what the Bible says in Daniel 7:25. And he shall speak great words against the Most High, and shall wear out the saints of the Most High. Can you think of any greater words against the Most High than claiming that it had authority to change God's law, particularly the Sabbath? And to think to change times and laws. This power would attempt to change the very law of God. This is obviously speaking about divine laws. It is not speaking about something insignificant like tax laws or political laws. Daniel 8:12 tells us that this little horn power would cast truth down to the ground. He did all this and prospered. So coming out of the old Roman Empire, a religious power would arise. It would be small at first, but it would become extremely powerful. It would claim that it had the authority to change the very law of God. And how did this change from Sabbath to Sunday actually occur? What happened historically? The change of the Sabbath occurred gradually over a period of time. It resulted in a variety of social and religious factors. Dr. John Eadie helps us to understand the roots of this change in his Bible Encyclopedia on page 561. He says, Sabbath, a Hebrew word signifying rest. Sunday was a name given by the heathens to the first day of the week because it was the day on which they worshiped the sun. Sun worship was common in Egypt, Babylon, Persia, and Rome. When you come to the 4th century, the Roman Emperor Constantine had strong devotion to the worship of the sun. even putting the sun god on the coins he minted. He also had a big problem. Rome was falling apart, and Constantine desired to unite his empire. How could Constantine unite his empire? Constantine came up with what he thought was a brilliant idea. Why not unite the empire around Sunday worship? Here's the emperor's decree from AD 321. He says, "On the venerable day of the sun, let the magistrates and people residing in cities rest, and let all the shops be closed." Constantine calls Sunday the venerable day of the sun. He declares all workshops be closed. In an attempt to unite the empire, Constantine issued the first Sunday law. In the days of Constantine, church and state united in an attempt to Christianize the pagans and unite the empire. The Roman government and the Roman church united. Here's an amazing statement that is really incredible. It's from March 1994 in the Catholic World, page 809. "The sun was a foremost god with heathendom. There is, in truth, something royal, kingly about the sun, making it a fit emblem of Jesus, the Son of Justice." Hence the church in these countries would seem to have said, "Keep that old pagan name. It shall remain consecrated, sanctified." And thus the pagan Sunday, dedicated to Balder, became the Christian Sunday, sacred to Jesus. Do you see how it happened? Do you see how Sunday came into the church? Christians, to escape persecution, had for several hundred years been seeking to distinguish themselves from the Jews. Sunday gradually became emphasized because of Christ's resurrection, and gradually church leaders, to make the pagan sun worshipers more comfortable, started keeping Sunday in place of the Bible Sabbath. Constantine wanted to unite his empire, and Roman church leaders wanted to convert the pagans. Sunday became the vehicle to accomplish both. So the biblical Sabbath was changed by the Roman church and state. God didn't change it. The disciples didn't change it. Jesus didn't change it. The Catholic Church Council of Laodicea records the first prohibition of keeping the Bible Sabbath. The Roman Catholic bishops met there, and look what happened. Council of Laodicea, AD 325. "Christians shall not Judaize, that is, they shall not keep the Sabbath and be idle on Saturday, but the Lord's Day they shall especially honor, and, as being Christians, shall, if possible, do no work on that day. If, however, they are found Judaizing, they shall be shut out from Christ." So here is a church council that unites with the Roman government under Constantine and says, "We are shifting the authority of Sabbath to Sunday. This will unite the empire and distance us from the Jews." In doing so, however, they were unconsciously fulfilling Daniel's prophecy in verse 25, "and shall think to change times and laws." Daniel 7:25 says that an earthly power growing up out of Rome would attempt to change God's law. God says, beware. Listen to what the Convert's Catechism, a Roman Catholic instructional guide, correctly says regarding the change of the Sabbath. It is clear. Question: which is the Sabbath day? Answer: Saturday is the Sabbath day. Question: why do we observe Sunday instead of Sabbath? Answer: because the Catholic Church transferred the solemnity from Saturday to Sunday. Let's go to the Catholic Encyclopedia. We are looking at Volume 4, page 153. The Church, after changing the day of rest from the Jewish Sabbath of the seventh day of the week to the first, made the third commandment refer to Sunday as the day to be kept holy, as the Lord's Day. The Catholic Encyclopedia states that the commandment regarding time had been changed by the Church. By the way, some may have noticed that this statement refers to the third commandment, but the Sabbath is the fourth commandment. The Roman power of the Middle Ages also changed the law of God by removing the second command, the one prohibiting image worship, and the tenth, "thou shalt not covet." This they divided into two. Carl Keating, one of the foremost Catholic lay scholars, wrote a book as a challenge to Protestants, Catholicism and Fundamentalism, page 38. fundamentalists meet for worship on Sunday. Yet there is no evidence in the Bible that corporate worship was to be made on Sundays. The Jewish Sabbath, or day of rest, was of course Saturday. It was the Catholic Church that decided Sunday should be the day of worship for Christians in honor of the resurrection. This Catholic author is reasoning with Protestants. He says if you want to go by the Bible, you should keep the Bible Sabbath. If you don't want to go by the Bible, you should go back to the Catholic Church, who freely claims the authority to change God's law as it sees fit. This is a powerful argument used by a prominent Catholic scholar as late as 1988. The issue is much more than a matter of one day versus another. The issue is, what is your guide? Is it the Bible or is it tradition? The issue is, does any human church or human religious leader, for whatever reason or motive, have the authority to change God's law that was written with His finger on those tables of stone? And so the issue is one of authority. In Psalm 89:34, God says, "My covenant I will not break, nor alter the word that has gone out of my lips." God says, "My covenant I will not break. The word I spoke on Sinai and wrote with my own finger, I will not change." It is a matter of authority. The issue is a matter of, who is your master? Is it Jesus or the leaders of the church? What is the foundation of your faith? Is it the Bible or is it what man says? What is the basis of authority in spiritual matters? The church or God's will? The Bible Sabbath, given by God as a sign of His creative authority, does matter, friend. I would much rather follow what God gave to Adam in the Garden of Eden. I would much rather follow what God gave to Moses in the Ten Commandments. I'd much rather follow the example of Jesus Christ Himself. What about you? God says the Sabbath is a great sign. It's a sign of our loyalty to Christ. It's a sign we believe He created our world. It's a sign that we want to follow all His word. That's why in the last days of Earth's history, in Revelation 14:12, God's word says, "Here is the patience of the saints. Here are those who keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus." In the last days of Earth's history, God will have a group of people who love Jesus. They will love Him so much that they obey Him. It's more than a matter of days. In the Garden of Eden, Satan said to Eve, "What difference does a tree make? All trees are alike." And Eve lost Eden because she bought that lie. And many Christians today are buying into a deception. People say, "What difference does a day make? All days are alike." With God, all days are not alike. One day was blessed by God, the seventh. One day was sanctified by God, set aside, the seventh day. And God rested on only one day, the Sabbath. The issues that we are dealing with are issues of authority, issues of obedience. Our choice is the Bible or tradition, Jesus or religious leaders, God's law or man's dogmas, God's instruction or human teaching, God's way or man's way. And God says to you and me tonight, choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Can you say tonight, "Yes, I choose Jesus. I choose His way. I choose to lovingly obey His law." Now the question is sometimes asked, are you suggesting that everybody who keeps Sunday is lost? Let's be clear. Everybody who keeps Sunday is not lost. There are many Sunday-keeping Christians who love Jesus Christ. They are living up to all the light that they know. When they learn more, they are willing to follow it. All over the world, tens of thousands are hearing God's call and stepping out for His truth. Would you like to say tonight, "Yes, Lord, You have revealed Your truth, and like Joshua, I choose to follow You. I want to follow Jesus today." Jesus is calling you today. He is calling you to step out of the crowd. He is calling you to follow Him. He is appealing to you to accept His word and His word alone as the basis of your faith. If this is your desire and you would like to follow Jesus all the way, including obedience to the true Bible Sabbath, just write in the comment section below, "Jesus, I choose to follow you all the way. Amen." Many of you may have questions about the Sabbath, such as how do I keep the Sabbath? When exactly does the Sabbath begin and end? What if I have a job or school on the Sabbath? These questions and more will now be answered on a special Sabbath question and answer session on this channel. If this video has been helpful to you, please like and share it with others. This video is part of a series called Final Days. I encourage you to watch this full series in order by clicking the link on the screen. If you're new, please subscribe and turn on all bell notifications so you hear about our next videos. But most importantly, friend, keep your eyes on Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith.